This episode of the Art of Manliness podcast is brought to you by the Art of Manliness store at store.artofmanliness.com. You can find all sorts of Art of Manliness swag. We got t-shirts, posters featuring Rudyard Kipling's poem, If, Theodore Roosevelt's Man in the Arena speech, the poem Invictus. We got morale patches, if that's your thing. Shaving gear, pocket knives, you name it, we got over there. All your purchases in the Art of Manliness store help support the Art of Manliness podcast, as well as what we do here at theartofmanliness.com, all the content we put up there. And if you'd like a discount on your first purchase at the Art of Manliness store, we got a code for you. If you use code AON podcast at checkout, you'll get 10% off your first purchase. Again, store.artofmanliness.com, code AON podcast at checkout for 10% off. Brett McKay here, and welcome to another edition of the Art of Manliness podcast. Developed for the Israeli military forces and battle-tested in real-life tactical situations by police and military forces around the world, Krav Maga has gained an international reputation as an easy-to-learn yet highly effective combative and self-defense system. Today on the podcast, I talk to David Kahn, chief instructor of the U.S.-Israeli Krav Maga Association, and the author of several books on Krav Maga, including Krav Maga Defense. David and I discuss the origins and history of Krav Maga, its philosophy and fundamental moves, and how to use the system's combatives in a defensive scenario. Really fascinating show. After the show's over, check out the show notes at aom.is/Krav Maga, all one word, where you can find links to resources where you can delve deeper into this topic. David Kahn, welcome to the show.
Hey, Brett. Great to be on with you.
So you are a Krav Maga instructor, the chief officer at Israeli Krav Maga here in the United States. Before we get into talking about Krav and what exactly it entails, can you tell us a bit about your background? How did you get involved in Krav Maga? And I mean, what are the types of people you train as a Krav Maga instructor?
Sure. My first experience with Krav Maga was my first week of law school, and the experience floored me literally. The first American to ever do Krav Maga, Rick Blitstein. I had played Ivy League football, and I wanted to try some kind of self-defense, and I wanted immediate gratification, as all people seem to. And Rick took a look at me, and he thought that'd be a good example, and he took me in what we call cavalier, which is a wrist takedown, and he ended up with his size 8.5 on my neck in front of all these people. And while I should have been embarrassed, I thought it was the coolest thing in the world, and I said, I got to do that. So that's how I stumbled literally on Krav Maga. I didn't know what it was. I probably even mispronounced it the first few times I took it. But it's become really quite popular, and that's a good thing for the most part, although obviously there are certain criminal elements that are trying to get their hands on it as well. And my background, again, I'm a non-practicing attorney. I work with technologies. I write patents, and I love teaching Krav Maga. Been fortunate enough to write 5 books on it. Matter of fact, the fourth book just won a National Book Award, as we mentioned, in the category of sports, although it's anything but sporting. And it was called Professional Tactics. So that was a real nice award with all the major publishers competing for the title. And fortunately, we took it. We actually won a similar award, that exact same award back in 2010 with a weapons defense book. So in addition to the books we've been able to write, we've done a bunch of DVDs, 4 different sets. And through it all, we've been contacted by most of the major law enforcement agencies we've trained to date, the veritable alphabet of the federal agencies, FBI, DEA, Secret Service, Marshal Service, Department of Corrections, Department of Justice Police, Department of Defense Police, et cetera, Coast Guard. And then, fortunately, all 5 branches of the United States military, including the Coast Guard. We were invited down to Quantico to train with the Marine Corps, which also then led to an FBI invitation to train at their academy with them, along with the DEA. Trained some tier 1 groups, and it's really just been a marvelous thing. And
right, so I mean, what are the origins of Krav Maga? So it's called Israeli Krav Maga, so I'm imagining it originated in Israel, but why did the self-defense system originate in Israel?
It actually originated in early 1940s and late 30s in Slovakia by a man named Emrich Lichtenfeld, who founded the system. And Emi had a background in boxing and in Western wrestling and judo. His father was a chief inspector for the Slovakian police, but it was developed and invented out of necessity to protect the Jewish community. And the difference between the nascent Krav Maga training and sport fighting was simply that Krav Maga, as it was really self-defense. It didn't get called Krav Maga until the late 40s, but such as it was developed, again, to protect the Jewish community. And the key differentiator was that there were no rules in a street fight, and that Emi was always outnumbered along with his colleagues who helped him. And he realized right away that, again, there could be no sporting applications, which means there are no rules, but most importantly, every combative or strike or countermeasure had to count. There was no room for wasted motion or ineffective combatives. In other words, a punch had to be a knockout if it could be. A kick had to take out a knee. A knee had to knee somebody in the groin. An eye gouge had to do the trick and distract, and then he could move on to the next opponent. So by its very nature, it was visceral. It was meant only for self-defense, not to use, be used offensively. And Emi ended up emigrating from or escaping the Nazis in Slovakia and ended up fighting for the British Army in North Africa. And he was wounded, he was decorated, and then he made his way to what was to become Israel. And the early Israeli military leaders recognized that Emi had a distinct talent for hand-to-hand combat and a great way of teaching. And they suggested that he ramp this up for the fledgling Israel Defense Forces, which had at that point been a number of organizations, including the Haganah, the Palmach, and the Palyam, which were really self-defense groups. And they formed the National Army, which was Israel Defense Forces. And to this day, Krav Maga is the official hand-to-hand combat system. The Krav Maga that's taught in the Israeli military does differ in different units. It's not uniform, but it is still called Krav Maga. And we call it Israeli Krav Maga because it comes from the Israeli Krav Maga Association. There are many different types of Krav Maga that people have put spins on, but we refer to it as Israeli Krav Maga because it is the original organization with the most evolved Krav Maga.
And Krav Maga, that's a Hebrew word, right?
Yep, means contact combat or close combat. Krav means a struggle. First used in the Old Testament when, as my research seemed to show, that Gabriel struggled as opposed to fought with the angel of death. And it's used elsewhere. And Maga means proximity. And actually, in my fourth book, I had I'm forgetting it right now, but I'll come back to it if you'd like. It's actually one of the original explanations behind Krav Maga about preparing one's fingers for battle and my hands for war. That's one of the first references to the word.
Oh, that's cool. So you kind of hit on some of the principles of Krav Maga. So it's, you know, make every strike count, just basic motor movements. Beyond that, are there some other principles that guide Krav Maga?
Yes, there are. Like every good self-defense, it's to recognize the incipient conflict or violence that's coming to you or, you know, targeting you and to avoid it. It's just better to see that this is not going to end up in a good situation and to extricate yourself. But if push comes to shove and we've got to react physically, in other words, all de-escalation, the deconfliction, anything you can say is not going to deconflagrate the situation. Krav Maga focuses on preemptive action. In other words, if you see that an attacker is winding up to hit you or going to deploy a weapon against you from the waistband, the back, or is palming a weapon, will preempt, and that could be any number of counterattacks, but they're meant to cause injury, not necessarily to hurt, but to cause injury to survive the situation. Coupled with that is the all-important principle of simultaneous defense and attack, which simply means that every defensive measure that's taken, a counterattack is also launched. So if somebody were throwing a punch at your head, using the preemptive self-defense, you could use a straight punch because a straight attack will always reach the target faster than a round attack. And incidentally, it takes about three times as long to land a hook punch as it does a straight punch. But if you wanted to defend the straight punch with a simultaneous defense and attack principle, you would defend with the near side arm. If it's a right punch, you defend with your left. You would block using a rotational defense to attack the attacker's arm while simultaneously either punching or using a palm or an eye strike to the attacker's face. So you're blocking and attacking at the same time and simultaneous defense and attack.
Is that RETZEV, like R-E-T-Z-E-V?
That's a method of counterattacking developed by Grandmaster Chaim Gidon, my instructor. I'm very proud to be a student. And that means continuous combat motion. Basically, it's harnessing the body's natural movements. It's using optimized combatives. In other words, as I land a kick to the knee or the groin, my weight is already transferring forward, allowing me to use that same side punch, like a left kick to the groin, imagine, followed by immediately by a left punch, followed by a right punch. And because of my weight now coming forward with a right punch, it optimizes a right knee. So basically, it's harnessing the body's momentum, and it's creating an economy of motion, and it's either recognizing an opportunity to strike a vulnerable anatomy in a in an assailant, or creating your own opportunity by a salvo of strikes. I can put it to you this way. Maybe it is the equivalent of a single shot from maybe a semi-automatic rifle hitting where you need to hit, and then the rifle opens up fully automatic. So it's like a single fully automatic burst of attacks, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that does make sense. So what do you think is the mindset shift that needs to take place for people to use Krav Maga effectively compared to the mindset they might have with other defensive systems?
Well, I think that all good systems share the mindset that we really emphasize, which is attack the attacker. That person intends to do you harm. You've got to react with extreme prejudice where the situation warrants it, and I'm going to say neutralize a threat. Now, people can interpret neutralize as they wish, but basically, I'm a lawyer by training, so it's very important for civilians to understand that they've got to use proportional force. In other words, you can counterattack until that threat, that person can no longer counterattack you. But if you continue, to administer punishment because you're angry after the fact, that's going to come back and haunt you legally and morally, perhaps as well. But it's really an aggressive mindset. It's that I'm not going to lose this, and it doesn't matter what that other person knows. I'm going to take the fight to him or her because they've given me no choice, and I'm going to end it quickly on my terms. Again, it's an overwhelming counterattack, and again, it's with extreme prejudice. There's just, you've got to reconcile yourself that you've done everything you can to avoid this situation. The attack is coming your way, and you've got to defeat it. Whatever it takes.
So you mentioned that part of Krav Maga is going for inflicting damage to very vulnerable parts of the body. What are those vulnerable parts that Krav focuses on, and how do you go about attacking them?
Yeah, the primary targets, of course, the obvious ones: the eyes, the temple, the throat, the sides of the neck, the groin, the knees, and then you've obviously got the internal organs, including kidneys, spleen, the solar plexus, the mandible process, the back of the skull. It's really wherever you can cause damage. And what we mean by damage is structural damage to anatomy, either pushing the tissue beyond its natural elasticity, or dislocating joints, or breaking bones. Popping out an eyeball if you've got to do it. It's a life and death situation, by inserting your thumb and digging into the attacker's eye and gouging that eyeball out. And that's, as I said, that's visceral. And thank goodness that most people are averse to doing something like that. It has to be taught to most people, but some people come by it naturally. Again, this is when everything else has failed and there's no choice but to defend yourself.
How do you train for like gouging an eyeball out, right? Like, I see how you can train for a punch, right? Because you can punch a body, but gouging an eyeball, how do you practice for that?
Well, one way, of course, is if you have a practice dummy like a bob, but they're rather expensive. So we can do it a couple of different ways. When we actually practice with a partner, we only find the eyebrow. You find the cheekbone. In other words, if you have a listener trying this out in the sense, mentally, what you would do is you take your right hand, the person who's listening, I'm doing it right now as I speak, you put it on your left cheekbone. And by putting the hand on the left cheekbone, in other words, you're facing somebody else, but you're practicing on yourself, it automatically gives you a guide into the eye. It's called the rule of thumb, if you will. So obviously when we practice, like everything, we've got to use extreme control, which is one part of the Krav Maga training. In other words, I'm at the level, my senior instructors are, where we can actually kick somebody's knee without taking it out. We've got the control. But that has to be built up over time, and that takes proper instruction. So you ask a very good question. When I was working with one of the military branches, they were going to test whether Krav Maga worked or not. And very, very tough guys. And the guy, I put myself in a very bad position. I put myself in a guillotine on the ground. I said, okay, you can choke me out. And friend of mine, I won't say which branch, but the friend of mine said, I can really choke you out. He became my friend afterwards, as a matter of fact. I said, sure, if I pass out, I'll pass out. If I tap, I tap out. And again, he says, sir, I can really choke you out. I said, yeah, you can if you can. But what happened was I did the defense, and again, before I knew him well, he said, sir, my eyeball is coming out. I said, well, it's in release. I'm gritting my teeth as he's choking me, and I'm releasing. So you can put that kind of pressure into the eye lid, and people will generally relent, but you got to be careful.
Right. I know this probably sounds goofy. I think I read somewhere where someone like would put like orange slices like on a Bob dummy and like practice like sticking their thumb in the orange slice to get like get used to the feeling of putting their thumb in an eyeball. Oh man.
But no, that well could be. I mean, it's similar to using a watermelon when you're using edge weapons, you know, to understand how a blade is going to penetrate the human torso. It's about the same tension and suction. And same thing with biting. You know, when we have biting, sometimes you'll take a piece of fruit, an orange with the peel still on it. You'll use your incisors. You'll rip it out just to simulate biting. If you had to, you know, for example, bite somebody's neck if they were choking you from the front or wherever it may be, or bear hug is a better example of that. So you can definitely use all sorts of fruit or balloons or, you know, anything you want to simulate human anatomy.
Right. This is going to be funny. There's going to be like guys sticking their thumbs in oranges and their wives are going to come and like, what are you doing? And I'm training to gouge someone's eyeball out. Yeah, getting back to this idea of practicing for Krav, because it's a real world, right? And most of the situations you're going to encounter in real world defense, like you are not expecting it. So how do you train for an event you don't expect, right? Because like when you're training, you know the guy is going to attack you. So in Krav, how do you train yourself to be ready for those unexpected moments where you have to defend yourself?
Great question. Krav Maga is built on instincts, and we hone those instincts. For example, if something is unexpectedly thrown at your head or somebody were to swing at your head and you saw it coming, you would flinch. And that means that your arms would come up and you'd probably tuck your chin, raising your shoulders. So Krav Maga, to make it most effective, builds on our natural instincts. And for example, when you're caught what we call in the negative five, which is courtesy of a good friend of mine, Nir Maman, who headed up the counter-terror training in Israel for Krav Maga, when you're put in the negative five, you don't expect it. And that's where your trained tactics, your conditioned response has to come in. So we train to do just a few things very well that will handle the myriad attacks you might face. For example, the hook punch defense you're talking about, the outside movement to block it would be the same thing as a sucker punch from your left or your right. We see something coming to the head, we flinch, we move away from it as we deflect, and then counterattack if you can. So what it distills down to is just understanding a few core movements to get you off a line of attack or to react. And that has to come with training, but the great thing about Krav Maga, why people seem to enjoy it so much or find it so easy to learn and retain, is again, it's built on that flinch response. Or if, for example, if you were somebody were going to try to kick you in the groin, you know, another street trick. Most people, if they see it coming, will drop their hands or they'll cross their legs. Well, we don't want to drop the hands, but we will build on that crossing the leg response to deflect it with the forward leg. In other words, if you were, you know, you're standing there and somebody went at you, you turn to the side. Well, we build on that by using the forward leg to deflect and turn the attacker away, taking his dead side.
What does a typical session look like, right? So you can prepare yourself for these events that you're not expecting, right? Like, how do you train for the unexpected?
It might be helpful to say one thing about the Krav Maga, that not all Krav Maga training is the same, and that with our specific training, the Israeli Krav Maga from Grandmaster Gidon, we practice and we train against concerted resistance. In other words, somebody who's throwing a full force attack at you. Because if you don't train that way, you do yourself a disservice in three ways. One, the speed of the attack or the unexpectedness of the attack. So that's one and two. And then the ferocity of it, the power coming at you. So you've got to learn how to attack the best way you can in terms of simulating it. And by our combatives, we're actually throwing very good combatives, the most effective and optimized combatives. So when you can defend against those kinds of attacks where somebody's retracting the attacking limb very quickly to simulate, you know, a trained attacker, it's easier to defend against somebody who's not so trained. In other words, we're not spending a whole lot of time doing jumping jacks and sit-ups and push-ups and fighting in the air. So what we can do, for example, is we'll have a partner stand, the hands are down in a negative five position, you're not ready for a fight, and we'll have that partner circle around you know, the practice partner who's defending and throw any kind of attack. Doesn't matter what it is, and the attack, you know, it could be a punch, it could be a kick, it could be a choke, a push, a takedown, anything. And that's what we call open training, where you know something will happen, but you don't know what. As opposed to choreographed training, where you say, hey, I'm going to throw a punch at you now, which, of course, we build it up. Beginners would do the closed training where they know something is coming. But even within the closed training, we begin to build it out. Like, for example, you don't know a punch from the left or the right or a hook from the left or the right. So it's a 25% proposition for each kind of attack you can get, but you've got to react. So using good, you know, MMA gloves and control, we will go at each other full force. In fact, it's one of my favorite practice drills. In addition, we also practice from what I'll call a de-escalation stance, which I talk a bunch about in the fifth book, Krav Maga Defense, where you're not putting your hands up in a fighting stance, because that's going to basically indicate that you're engaging in mutual combat, which where you lose your self-defense ability. You know, it's a fight, and you're not ready for it. So that's kind of my favorite kind of drill. We'll spar as well, you know, where the hands do go up and you're fighting, but that's the way we got to train. Same thing with getting choked from the rear. We'll walk up to somebody in the class and choke him or her if we understand they know the technique, and you'll have to react from, you know, an unprepared state. Because if you can react from an unprepared state, if you're prepared, obviously you've got the advantage.
So let's kind of talk about specific scenarios. So the basic idea of Krav, you're going to use your flinch, your startle reflex, use basic gross motor movements to go for vulnerable parts of the body. But let's say there's more than one attacker. So how do you, what's your strategy whenever you have two or three attackers on you? Because, I mean, they don't do it like in the movies where they just all wait around while one attacker goes for you and then the next one goes. Like, they're coming at you simultaneously.
No. No, you hit another great point. In fact, it's the very essence of Krav Maga. It's what Imi, the founder, had to face more times than not. And the key is you do not fight more than one person at a time. And you never get in the middle of multiple assailants, you know, especially if there were three assailants. In other words, let's say that the listener is facing three people to his or her left, middle, and right. Whatever happens, the defender is going to go to his or her left or right, but never down the middle, even if the attacker in the middle comes at you. And what we do is, again, we take the attack to the attacker, and we always try to line the attackers up, and that means brutalizing the closest threat, the near threat. If there's a weapon, we'll take it away and use it against all three. But you never want to fight two people at once, and you always want to keep moving. Remember, you're the target. They're not the target. They're trying to envelop you, and you gotta work effectively. Now, interestingly, one bit of tradecraft here. You get the old westerns where your people were outnumbered, and you, maybe it's two against four, and one guy says, "I'll take those two. You take the other two." That's not the way we do it either. If they were two against four, the two people would still fight one person, knock him or her down, you know, neutralize him, and then continue. But it's never fighting more than one person. And we'll fight two against one, four, in our favor, yeah, but not the other way around. We won't defend against two.
And you just mentioned improvised weapons. So is that an important part of Krav Maga as well?
Sure. Anything that you can pick up can be a weapon. Change in your hand can be held at your side. It can be launched at somebody's face with a simultaneous kick to the groin or the knee. You know, the keys are always thought of as slashing, but they can actually be used as a distraction, where you're getting the guy to put his hands up, clouding his vision, and then taking out his knee. You know, umbrellas, mobile phones. I've actually got a training curriculum for mobile phone use. You're gonna have a good insurance claim on your hand. I've developed a device too for that. We'll see how that turns out. And anything you can pick up, you know, a wall can be used as an improvised weapon too. If you do what we call tai sabaki, and you turn and you channel the attacker's momentum forward, and you use it to ram him into the wall. You know, car doors, anything and everything can be used by you, keeping in mind that it can also be used against you.
So the best defense, and I think all self-defense systems say, is the best defense is to avoid confrontation in the first place. You write a lot about this in your books. So what are some of the pre-conflict indicators that people should be looking out for? And what can you do to avoid or de-escalate these conflicts?
Terrific point. As all good self-defense will tell you, you know, it's using common sense first and foremost. I would also say you couple that with your intuition. There's a great book, and I would advise all readers to pick it up if they're interested in the topic, called The Gift of Fear by Gavin DeBecker. Very well-known book. Basically, what Gavin DeBecker is suggesting is that trust your gut. You will sense that there's a problem. If something doesn't feel right, it's not. Trust yourself. Forget social mores of, you know, offending somebody if you're in an elevator, that kind of thing. And again, there are different hooks that people use or different provocations. You know, so much of what people think of as violence is avoidable in social violence. And again, made a very important point in book number 5 about social violence versus raw violence. And social violence can be avoided. Somebody giving you a stare and hoping that you'll return the stare so they can escalate with you. It could be a verbal, you know, provocation. Hey, what are you looking at, for example, or, you know, something to that effect. And again, those things can be avoided or ignored. A couple tips maybe for our listeners here. If somebody looks at you and you return the gaze, any return gaze beyond 3 seconds, and emotional intent is usually indicated. In other words, if you look at somebody and then you look away, not down, and I'll explain that momentarily, but if you look away, you're not challenging him or her. If you look down, though, you break your gaze and look down, it may be just what that person wanted to see, because now you've shown that you're subordinate in some way. You look down. So if you can look to the side and keep panning for potential threats, let's say, then you've introduced a degree of equanimity. In other words, you're not challenging the person, but you're not backing down either. Verbal challenges can be, forgive the pun, a bit more challenging, simply because it's directed at you. It's a direct challenge or provocation. And, you know, you got to rehearse this ahead of time and say, hey, you know, if somebody gave me a problem, hey, you know, it looks like you had a tough day. I did too. Or a sincere apology may be in order, even though you may not have anything to apologize for, if you just want to avoid it. And much of this is just posturing. It's a form of social dominance where somebody wants to show off to either a peer, it could be a girlfriend, it could be even his or her own children, or, you know, group setting. Young males are more susceptible to it, obviously. And, you know, to that point, you just have to think about what you would say to try to deconflict the situation. I had an instance where I was on a train going from Newark, New Jersey, and for whatever reason, this hard-bitten guy with a tattoo on his face, a teardrop, in fact, you know, took issue with me, and he used the time-honored, hey, what are you looking at? And I thought, ah, here we go. But I said to him, rather than saying nothing, I said, is that your beautiful baby girl? And he looked at me a bit startled, and I said, is that your beautiful girl? I said, she's about 13 months. And he didn't know what to say other than smile. And the mother, he's the father, the mother was smiling from ear to ear because I talking about their child with sincerity. And I opened the train door, or I held it for them, and rather than having an aggressor going back and forth, you know, I made a cursory friend and wished them have a great day when they left. So it changed from his wanting to start in with me to changing the subject sincerely and getting him off target, me.
Right. I love that. It's great advice there. So David, in martial art, in combative circles, there's always enormous debate about which system is the best. I mean, things can get really heated. And what kinds of criticism do you think people give levy at Krav Maga, and how do you counter those criticism?
Now, again, another great question, Brett. You know, I'll begin with the explanation that good minds think alike. For example, when I was just teaching a special forces group, and when we approach these fantastic fighters and these hardened warriors and heroes in my book, the idea is to introduce just a few tactics that they might use to augment what they do. It's not to replace what they do. And that's respect from us towards their professionalism. Because the fact is that only a few things out there, you're not going to reinvent the wheel with combatives, for example, a thumb gouge to the eye, a chop to the, you know, the carotid sheath, a thrust to the windpipe, a kick to the groin, that kind of thing. But what counts is how you deliver them and the method in which you deliver them. And I'm not in any way going to say that Krav Maga is the best fighting system in the world. Obviously, I'm biased towards it. It's what we do. But when we talk about fighting systems, you have to equate the time it takes to get proficient, which is why Krav Maga is so popular, because you can ramp up in a very short order. versus some of the more complicated systems, which are no doubt very, very formal fighting systems, but they do take a long time to master. And equally important, not everyone may be able to do it. Because remember, with the Krav Maga training, or the evolution of it, EMI and the subsequent IDF instructors had to be able to teach 18-year-old recruits along with men in their 50s who were doing the reserve duty, which is not as old today, but it's the same thing. So it's got to work for everybody. It's got to work for people who are large, small, athletic, not athletic, infirm, even people with disabilities in a wheelchair. And that's where Krav Maga sort of stands out. The one difference I will say, and I'll go down on a limb here, is that our weapon defenses may be, and I say may, be some of the best in the world because it was developed around modern weaponry. For example, our handgun disarms, our long gun disarms, again, it's not a time-honored system from several hundred years ago now trying to morph itself and to change the way they do things to take away an AK-47. The AK-47 existed and Krav Maga was developed in a way to take it away. But the system does change too. For example, the weaponry in the IDF now, they're using bullpup design submachine guns. You don't have a very long weapon. So the Krav Maga, the combatants with the weapon change as well in the tactics. So to answer your question further on comparing systems, that's sort of like discussing religion and best not to sometimes. But as I say, I have respect for everything. If somebody has a very strong background in most systems and they come to a Krav Maga training, the Krav Maga instructor has got to be good and legitimate. In other words, in my opinion, having trained with one of the top guys in Israel, there are really about three organizations there now, obviously the top, in my opinion, being Grandmaster Gidon. The point is that you've got to be able to handle yourself in any situation, multiple opponents, and you got to be proficient in everything from weapon defenses to ground survival to multiple opponents to being able to roll and find what we call cover in an active shooter situation, or if necessary, take an active shooter down, pummel them, take the weapon away, and hopefully get some help.
Well, David, let's say someone's listening to this conversation, and they say, I want to get started with Krav Maga. I mean, what's the best way to get started?
Best way is to take a look, what are the local schools around you, listener, and try it out and see if it's a good fit. The Krav Maga that we specifically teach, it takes a long time to develop instructors. We really have to master it per the original Israeli Krav Maga Association guidelines. As I said, some training's going to be better than nothing. We do have some online training, which is becoming increasingly popular. It's basically, I succeeded in getting 90% of the system online, and it's about 42 hours, 350 lessons worth. But that is meant to augment, in-person training. And so if people do look at our training materials, they will see differences in what we do versus many of the Krav Maga splinter groups out there. But I'm going to, just compliment Krav Maga as a whole, and, people should go out and try it. And I would suggest that if the organization or the instructor is good at what they do, two things will happen. One, they'll invite you in for a class as a trial, and they won't charge you. And two, they won't require you to sign a yearly contract, which I myself would be averse to, because you have to, as an instructor, believe that people are going to work because they love what you're doing. You're giving them something of great value, and they want to come back, as opposed to being charged every month and having to feel they've got to go back, if that makes sense.
And David, where can people learn more about your works, for example, your online courses?
Very kind of you, Brett. The website is www.masteringkravmaga.com. So it's www.masteringkravmaga.com, all one word. And our videos are very popular on Amazon. That's the best place to get them. In fact, the first video is actually Amazon's choice. It simply means that Amazon, because of the 250 ratings that have come in, and it's about a 4.85 out of 5, has designated it its choice for anything that's typed in Krav Maga, along with the 5 books that are available. So that, much appreciated for the opportunity to explain where to get our stuff.
Well, David, this has been a great conversation. Thank you so much for your time. It's been a pleasure.
Thanks so much. And I just encourage everybody to be safe, and I really appreciate the interest in Israeli Krav Maga. And lastly, any questions about it generally can be answered on our website, www.israelikrav.com. So that's israelikrav.com.
My guest today was David Kahn. He's an instructor at the U.S. Israeli Krav Maga Association, the author of several books on Krav Maga, including Krav Maga Defense, his latest. They're all available on Amazon.com. He's also got some DVDs, which I own, which are pretty cool. You can also find out more information about the U.S. Israeli Krav Maga Association